Good morning. And welcome to our worship service this morning as we celebrate Palm Sunday. There are a couple of changes due to the nature of the day. First of all of your liturgy is at your bulletin. You will only need the hymnal for the final hymn. The opening hymnal will be this green insert that you should have received, along with a palm. How it goes is you want, where it says 220 at the top, you sing the first two verses, then flip it over to the back side and sing the last part on the back side. Also, because this is Palm Sunday, at the beginning of Holy Week, we leave out some of our liturgy, both in the service of the Word and in the celebration of communion. We do not do the Sanctus or the Agnus Dei, the Holy, 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 or the Lamb of God. It's a much shortened liturgy. Also, I speak the Great Thanksgiving instead of chanting it, again due to the nature of the day. So, I would ask that you turn to page 2 and invite those who can do so without difficulty to please stand as we prepare our hearts and minds for worship with the order of confession. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit, that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one. Most merciful God,
we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of our Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by his accord, I therefore declare you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Ask that you now take out the green insert, where the sign of the difference is 1 and 2.
Thank you. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Save me in your steadfast love. Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness. And being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bend in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Hosanna, Hosanna to the King, Hosanna.
verse 7. King Solomon writes, quote, "For as he thinks in his heart, so he is," end of quote. As we think in our hearts, so we are. What Solomon is telling us is that what we think determines our attitudes and our actions. If we think about Christ, if we think about God, if that is our priority, that determines our actions and our attitude. If we think about the things of the world, those things that are temporary, then that controls our actions and our attitudes. When we do something senseless, we claim that we were out of our mind. We didn't know what we were doing. Well, in our second lesson for today, that is the feeling of St. Paul with his attitude toward the church in Philippi. He is going out of his mind. The problem being that the Philippians have demonstrated an attitude of being haughty and proud. And this haughtiness and pride has caused there to be divisions within the church. And these divisions are threatening the very existence. So St. Paul tells them that what they need is a change of mind. A mind that is one of humility and obedience, as illustrated by our Lord Jesus Christ in his passion, beginning with that triumphal entry today in Jerusalem. As St. Paul says at the beginning of our lesson today, "Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus." Have this mind. What does that mean? What kind of mind is he talking about? The word translated as mind means to have the same attitude as someone, to be of the same mind, to be disposed in a certain direction, or to have affection for. So St. Paul is telling the Philippians and telling us today as 21st century Christians that we are to have affection for, we are to have the same attitude, we are to have the same mind, we are to be disposed for the mind of Jesus Christ. And what was the mind of Jesus Christ? He tells us of two actions that we need to take as followers of his. The first is to have a mind of Christ, is to have a mind of humility. The word, and as he says in verse 8, "And being found in human form, he humbled himself." And humility, or to be humble, is not a popular word in some areas of our society today. We have far too many people today who want to put themselves first. They demand that what they think is what everybody else should do. They think that what they want is what everybody else should want. And they have no tolerance for those who may have a different opinion. And so they don't want to be humble. They don't want to deal with humility. But that is what St. Paul is saying, that we as followers of Jesus Christ are to have, to be humble, to practice humility. At the University of Copenhagen in Denmark, there is a famous statue by the Danish sculptor Thorvaldsen, and it is a statue of Jesus standing up with his arms outstretched and giving the invitation, "Come unto me." It is said that in order to receive the full impact of that statue, and to realize what a great work Thorvaldsen did, is that to appreciate it, you have to get on your knees and look up. And only then do you catch the full impact of Jesus' invitation to come unto him. Only then do you get the full impact of his face full of love and mercy, calling you unto him. And that is what Jesus did. He went from standing in the courts of heaven, sitting at the right hand of the Father, and came down, kneeling in the earth, on the earth, as a human being, while still being also the Son of God. He practiced that humility, and we are to do the likewise. The word humbled means to make low. It means to reduce yourself. It means to descend to a lower rank or a lower station or a lower place. It means to be ranked below those who are honored. That is the direction or the directive for a Christian. We are not to puff ourselves up. We are not to think we're so important. But we are to always be humble. Remember the parable Jesus told about the observance he made at the wedding, where he noticed how people were fighting for the best seats. And so then he talked a parable about going to a wedding, and the danger of setting yourself in the best seat is that the host may come up to you and say, somebody is here that's higher than you, and then in shame you have to go down all the way to the lowest seat, because that's the only one left. And he tells us the first will be last, and the last will be first. So we are to practice that humility, to be humble in all things. A young couple had been married for about a year when the wife was trying to convince her husband to throw out a bunch of his old ties and suits that she said were now no longer in style, but he insisted on that they were still stylish and he should still be able to wear them. After some more pleading, she finally convinced him to put some of these old ties and suits in the yard sale. So the day of the yard sale came, and the husband was standing there with his wife, and this woman came up, and she looked at the ties and suits, and she picked up a tie, she picked up a suit, and she said, "Perfect." With that, the husband turned to his wife and gave her the smug smile. "See, I told you this stuff was cool." Until he heard her next words. "These will look great on my scarecrow." He was humble. But that is what Jesus, or St. Paul, is telling us. Jesus wants us to do. He humbled himself. He went from the highest station possible to the lowest. And as his followers, we need to do the same. But oftentimes we find ourselves filling up with pride for something we've done, or we have people in our ear telling us how great we are, and then something happens that undoes them. I'm beginning to feel more and more sorrow for these young athletes today. They get all these hang-ons, tell them how great they are. They go off to college, and then they find out they're sitting on the bench and still instead of starting, but there was actually somebody better than them. Or they're fortunate enough to make it to the pros, and instead of being a big star, they're on the bench because somebody's better than them. But all their hang-ons keep telling them they're the greatest, they're the best, and they need to skip college and go right to the pros or whatever. And then they get home. Well, if you practice humility, you won't be embarrassed. One Sunday after church, a lady went through the line and shook the preacher's hand and said to him, "Preacher, that was a great sermon." And the preacher replied and said, "Well, don't thank me, thank God." And then she stopped and turned around back to him and said, "It wasn't that bad." See, you never know what somebody's going to hold. So it's better to practice it than to be embarrassed. The second attribute we are to have, another word that is very unpopular today among some section of our society, and that is the word obedience. To be obedient. It St. Paul says, speaking of Jesus, in being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on the cross. He became obedient. There are some today who don't want to be obedient. They don't like the law. They don't like the tradition. They don't like the culture. Then they want to disobey what everyone else takes for granted and follows without any problem. And so obedience is something that is sometimes difficult to have people do. A little boy was in his elementary school class, third grade class. Teacher said to him, said, "Billy, why do you keep sticking your stomach out?" And Billy said, "Well, this morning when I got to school, I went to the principal and told him I had a tummy ache. And he told me if I stuck it out until noon, I could go home." Well, at least that little boy was being obedient. The principal gave him an order and he was following the best of his ability. And St. Paul is encouraging us to do the same thing. The word obedience means to do the will of God. It means to submit to the Lord Jesus Christ. So as a follower of Jesus, we are to submit to God's will and to our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, what's interesting is the Greek word that's translated as obedient in English is actually a Greek word that's made up of three different words. And one of the words it's made up with is a word that means to give an ear to or to listen attentively. Which you can see then how that follows into being translated as obedient. If you are listening attentively to someone, if you're giving your ear to them, hear what they're saying, then that means you're more than likely going to be obedient. You're going to do what they say and follow their instructions. So St. Paul is saying, not only are we to do the will of God, not only are we to submit to the Lordship of Jesus Christ, but we are to listen attentively to and to give an ear to Jesus Christ and to the Holy Spirit, so that we constantly might be obedient, so that we can be obedient in all that we should be doing. The church is to follow Jesus Christ. The church is supposed to follow God's word. In our documents of faith, our statements of faith, we claim that God's word is the basis for all faith and belief. So why, in this 21st century, do we turn around and ignore God's word? What I mean by this is, St. Paul tells us at least twice in two different epistles that being in the body of Christ, being the church, there's neither man nor female, Jew or Greek, slave or free, but we're all one in Christ Jesus our Lord. The other apostles make it clear that there is to be unity in the church without separation due to any kind of these factors, race, creed, color, position, whatever. Jesus says, "I am the vine, you are the branches. Without me, you cannot have life." So that means everyone in the church is connected to Jesus Christ in that imagery of the vine and in the reality of the church. So someone please explain to me why, if we're all one and there's neither male or female, Jew or Greek, slave or free, why our national church and our synod persist in having conferences that divide us by race and creed? There are male clergy conferences. If we're all one, why are these clergy that aren't white males meeting separate from us? Why are they having a retreat one weekend and we're not invited? If we're all supposed to be one. If we're all supposed to be worshiping the same Lord, part of the same church. That's why I like to go to ecumenical meetings. Because they don't put the Catholic priest all in one place and an Episcopalian priest in another area and the Lutheran pastors in another and the Baptists in another and the Presbyterians and that separate us by our denomination. We're encouraged to intermingle. Because we're all followers of Jesus Christ. So why would we disobey a direct order that there is to be no separation and break this down into all these little subgroups which cause disunity instead of unity? But that's the way we see, or what we see, going on today. When the Lutheran World Federation meets, they don't separate it between North American clergy, and South American clergy, and African clergy, and Asian clergy, and island clergy. They just meet as a Lutheran World Federation. All the bishops from all the Lutheran churches in all the different countries, European clergy, are all together. So we are to follow what Jesus said. Being obedient, which means we recognize the only recognition we make is that we are all brothers and sisters in Christ Jesus. That is why he entered Jerusalem at first for the Apostle. Not that there would be division in his church, but that we would be one. That we would be one unified body of Christ. That we be one church all attached to that one branch of Jesus Christ. So we are to be obedient. And obedient to the Word of God in all situations. So what is to happen with this? By doing this, then we are given to the Holy Spirit that power to call upon the name of Jesus. So that the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. That is the result of obedience in humanity. Now, in society, and even in the church, there are certain positions that have power. If I would go to Columbus and walk into the governor's office, to his staff, and say, I'm Pastor John Pollock from St. John Springfield, Ohio. I'd like you to do this, this, and this for me. They wouldn't do a thing. And as I was being booted out the door, I would realize how my name means nothing in Columbus and the governor's name. But if the governor comes in and says, I want you to do something, they hop up and go do it. It's the same at a dinner at the White House. There's a certain protocol. And where you sit determines how important you are in the eyes of the president and the first lady at that time, or the State Department, or the military, or whoever influences those kind of things. So where you're sitting shows how important your name is. When the old Soviet Union was in power, observers used to watch whenever there was a parade at Red Square. They would watch the viewing stand on Lenin's tomb and see in what order the leadership was standing, because that told you who had the power, who was losing power, and who was gaining power, all by where they stood. No name has the power of Jesus Christ. No governor, no president, no prime minister, no premier, no emperor, no king, no mayor, no one has the power of the name of Jesus. And when we believe that name of Jesus gives us power that we can use in our daily life,
use Jesus' name like a good luck charm. Just shout his name if we don't believe. But if we believe it, if we believe that triumphal entry was done so that he would begin his passion and would culminate in his crucifixion to pay the debt of sin that we owe, and then on the third day rise to show us that by believing in him we have victory over sin, death, and the power of the devil, then by saying the name of Jesus, we have power when we say that name. At the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow and every tongue confess. That word confess means to agree together with God, to profess something, to agree with or to acknowledge belonging to the Lord. So when we confess, we are agreeing together with God that his Son, Jesus Christ, is indeed the Lord and Savior. He is truly the Messiah, the King, as he entered triumphantly into Jerusalem that first Palm Sunday. We are agreeing, or we are acknowledging, that Jesus is indeed the Christ, the Anointed, the Messiah, the Savior of the world. So being in our right mind is not to follow the actions of the world. It is not to have the attitude of the world, but it is to have the attitude and actions of our Lord Jesus Christ. Those attitude and actions which are summed up with humility and obedience, and then use the power of the name of Jesus to help proclaim his good news throughout the world. So with the help of the Holy Spirit, let us live each day in humility and obedience to our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus.
Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen, we believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was an incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Your mercy is great.
O God, may your grace sustain all who face religious persecution, abuse, or discrimination of any kind. Bless those who are sick and sorrowful with your comforting presence. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
O God, guide those who are
mercy is great.
O God, your days are without number and your love is without limit. Keep us in communion with those who have entered into your endless joy and bring us with them into the fullness of light. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Mercy, O God, hear our cry when we call to you. Renew and uphold us with your Spirit through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. To give our thanks and praise.
Holy God, mighty Lord, gracious Father, endless is your mercy and eternal your reign. You have filled all creation with light and life. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. We praise you for the grace shown to your people in every age, the promise to Israel, the rescue from Egypt, the gift of the promised land, the words of the prophets, and at the end of all the ages, the gift of your Son, who proclaimed the good news in word and deed, and was obedient to your will, even to giving up. And the night when she was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is new covenant, my blood shed for you, for all people, for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." For as often as we eat of this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Therefore, O God, with this bread and cup, we remember the life our Lord offers for us, and believing the witness of his resurrection, we await his coming in power to share with us the great and promised peace. Amen.
Come, Lord Jesus.
Send now, we pray, your Holy Spirit, that we who share in Christ's body and blood may live to the praise of your glory and receive our inheritance with all your saints and all. Amen.
Come, Holy Spirit.
Join our prayers with those of your servants at every time and every place, and unite them with the ceaseless petitions of our great high priest, until he comes as victorious Lord of all. Through him, with him, in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
Gathered in the one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus called us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Come to the banquet, for all is now ready.
Those who can, please stand. Honor our Lord Jesus Christ, and precious blood strengthen, preserve, and true faith, and the life eternal. Thank you.
That concludes our Palm Sunday service. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Our telephone number is 937-325-3708. Next Sunday, next week, Thursday, there will be a service at 2 and 7 o'clock. On Friday, Good Friday, there will be a service at 2 and 7 o'clock. Sunday, April 1st, Easter Sunday, services are 8 and 10:30. There will be an Easter breakfast at 9 o'clock until 10:15, and there will be an Easter egg hunt for the children.